And it's really kind of, I think, a very important effect, which tells that in classical physics, what's important are fields. Because we have particles, and these particles change their motion because of presence of fields. And in classical physics, people involved invented potential, a very useful device, because sometimes it's you can find out easier using potential energy what will happen. But really, everything happens because fields, and potentials are only kind of a tool. You make a gradient of potential, and you know, some other derivative potential give you a field. And the field, this is what acts on particles. And Haralambon effect is was a revolution. It says that no, really, potentials have physical effects by themselves. So he found these two situations in which particles go in places where there are no fields, and they still feel something. So the existence of potential change their motion. Maybe again a prelude. There's no more t-shirt like this, but there are t-shirts like this, and I don't want that Gregory will take them home. And the definition, it should be correct, should be the best. So I think the three or four best solutions will get t-shirts of different sizes. So please, please, I see all pages are here, looks like. You didn't try. So whatever try you do, you just have to be better than others. But maybe just submitting a page, please. What?
An empty page might do.
Yes, empty page will have no mistakes. So. Or maybe it will be better than nothing. Okay. So, but in this talk, again, now I have difficulty because the last part I don't want to take out. Not see if I kind of take something, some of the middle part. Divided it like five paradoxes. In fact, there will be six. The sixth one, it's the one which I presented in the beginning, essentially. And I understand that some people gave me some hints about the solution. Okay. And again, Mach-Zehnder interferometer, I think, as I said, half of my publication use Mach-Zehnder interferometer. So this device is that we send the single particles, and somehow they behave strangely, because this is a 50-50 bit splitter. As you see, when you send it here, it's supposed to go here and here. And this is also 50-bit splitter, but it's never come here, because there is interference of the from here and from here. So the particle is kind of a wave, it can interfere. So it's a very strange phenomenon. And so we have two like this, and they behave differently if the initial condition are different. You see, there they go in a different direction. Why? Because here it starts from here, and here it starts from here. So then even in between, they're kind of similar, but in the end, they behave differently. And there is understanding in quantum mechanics what's really going on. Because saying that the particle is really a wave, and local interaction may affect the particle. So maybe kind of more precise, or maybe more detailed explanation. The particle is kind of a wave. It goes here. It has this two wave bucket here and here. As one wave, another wave. It bounces on the mirror. It comes here. There is this relative phase which is important. And this relative phase tell us where it goes? The relative phase will be minus. You see, now it's plus, and so what come out here, it's the same wave, two wave. Constructive interference, we get a signal here, but here destructive interference. We get anything. And so we can play with this interferometer and really to see that we understand it well. I can move this mirror slightly. If I move this mirror slightly, then the distance here is slightly smaller, so it will come here first before this one. And if it will be half a wavelength before, so what we'll see, now we'll have, here we'll have constructive interference, here destructive interference. And so the particle will come here. So we can make this experiment, it's hard to do in laboratory all the time, we tune our interferometer and we can fix where will be constructive and destructive interference. And everything is kind of, this is good explanation, I believe good explanation. When everything kind of local, I understand. Here it's locally split, here it's locally pushed. And there is interference, because at the end of the day, what from me, quantum mechanics tell us, forget about particles, so all are waves. So particles is a good name, it's waves of particles. Particles give us degree of freedom. But essentially all are waves. And quantum physics provides good explanation. Good explanation. I think for me it's a local explanation. When I can understand like local action. Local action explain things, how things will go. Okay. So in this kind of interferometer we can understand by classical leg what happened. If we have two wave packets and we somehow arrange a classical leg between one and the other one, in the end we'll get different interference. We also can, there is a field, there is mathematics, if it's part of the wavelength, it's kind of a phase. So essentially there is a phase. When I move it a little, it's kind of very long, if I move it part of the wave, so I introduce this phase. And this simple expression, how to find this phase, shift relative to the wavelength multiplied by 2 pi, this give me the phase which I produce, my kind of introducing classical leg to one of the wavelengths. Okay, so let's again, how I understand Max Zeller interferometer. Here, if it starts from here, what will get here plus? But from here we get here minus. And then this minus phase between these two wave packets explain why it would come here will go down and plus will go up. And again, we could shift one of them and then change plus to minus, so that you could put them the same time. Now, what is the Aaron Bohm effect? Why it's so strange? We have this two Mach Zehnder interferometers for charged particles, and they're tuned in such a way that what will start here will go here. And this one is exactly the same one. The only difference, in addition, we put here a solenoid. Solenoid is something which keeps magnetic field inside, and there is nothing, no magnetic field outside. So from field point of view, there is no field outside. So this electron go with a free field region. And but for particular flux, we can arrange that it will go in the wrong way.
Now let me maybe briefly explain. A solenoid means a wire that's winding around some tube, and there's a current in this wire, so you get a magnetic field, and that's just inside the tube.
So again, I start from here and here, it's supposed to go here, but here, in where there is this magnetic field inside, then it goes this way. And so I start A plus B, and A plus B like here. Here I start plus. But since I know it will go down, it must be here minus. So somehow I get this minus.
It's easy to get this minus by classical leg, I will push something. But the point is that it's not clear how I'll get this classical leg, because there is no field acting on these wave packets. And this is this famous paper. In fact, there are two, I also mentioned, this is magnetic Bohm effect. This is also electrostatic the Bohm effect. We can put particle inside, we split the particle inside two Faraday cages, and when the inside Faraday cages, there's no field inside cage, but we change the potential between them. The changing potential, we change kind of the phase between them as they go out, so there will be different interference. And so this is the available effect paper. So, what is very strange here? We have so many causes a relative phase, but the time that the phase is given, we don't know. Because it's really, there's no field outside, there is only potential. Potential is not something locally measurable. You can use different gauge. If the Coulomb gauge, maybe it's kind of easier, and it's but now this phase is gradually changed from here up to this minus sign. But you can also use some singular gauge. Then there is no really potential anyway. That's this kind of sheet of vector potential here. And so the jump is supposed to be just when it crosses here. So it's plus until here and then suddenly minus. So it's kind of strange physically, and it's not clear how it happens. We can also arrange here that it's happened here, but it's just gauge. It just moments how we present it. Nothing physical is supposed to be changed. Gauge does not supposed to change anything physical. So the paradox of Aronov-Bohm effect is that every place of the path of the wave of the electron, there is no observable action. If we make whatever measurement here, this solenoid and without solenoid, we will never see any difference. And it's true about any place of this trajectory. There is no any physical way to know about the presence of this solenoid. Nevertheless, somehow this electron, when it goes around and meet again, then it behaves different. So, this is the main paradoxical feature of Aronov-Bohm effect, but let me discuss some other related paradoxes. So, the first kind of smaller paradox is following. There are some papers, some I related, some others, which tell that when we have a particle here and here, the relative phase can be measured locally. There is a meaning for this relative phase. Now, in Aronov-Bohm effect, we somehow get the relative phase. We get the relative phase pi, because this explains why it's go here, not here. But Aronov-Bohm effect tells us we don't know where this relative phase appears. On the other hand, there is a claim that we can go with measuring device and find out where this phase happened. So there is kind of, then Aronov-Bohm says, no, it's kind of strange topological effect. It doesn't happen in a particular place. But we can go with measuring device to find out where it's happened. So it's friction. Something doesn't go together. But once Aronov-Bohm effect is topological and no meaning, you cannot say where exactly this phase was acquired, and then you can measure it.
There's something I don't understand. So when you say you have these weight packets, okay, they're separated by 1 meter, I say.
Yes.
Now you say you want to observe the relative phase locally.
Yes.
Don't you have to bring these two packets together? Well,
no.
How do you observe
the relative phase? Okay, briefly, now explain how I do this. So the relative phase of a photon is observed locally. How we do this? I think Tan was essentially the paper with Tan, but then Pauli made a PRL, which was more known, the meaning, and the idea is following. So we have this photon in superposition being here and here, and here there is this relative phase. So how we can make to measure this relative phase? So we have ensemble like this, because we can repeat this. It doesn't, I don't need to make it on a single one. Every time I prepare exactly the same story, so I can, if I can measure an ensemble, it's good enough. So I can find, using ensemble, this phase. So this is A, this is B. All what I have to do, I have to say it kind of, it's always homodyne, heterodyne, it's this kind of detection. I put a laser here, and I will put a beam splitter which reflects most of it, and then using this, it's the statistics of what will be here can give me the place. Coherent state from here, coherent state from here, and it will give me the face. But maybe you ask this conceptual, this one have to understand optics to this kind of experiment. Maybe another way to explain how I can make, how I can find the relative face locally, maybe the simpler way. I will put a spin in magnetic field here, down. I will put spin in magnetic field here, down. I will arrange that my photon can give energy to the spin and flip it. So here there are two spins, both of them down. But then I have a mechanism which will absorb the photon and will flip it up. So in the beginning I have this superposition A plus B, E to the IB, and my photon, and I have a spin down and spin down. After the operation, I will arrange that the energy of the photon exactly good for flipping the spin, because it has energy. So after the operation, I will get down plus down e to the I phi down up. I will not have photon anymore. So in the beginning, I will have just down. I started with down down. But after the operation, I will get this. I will get entangled state of two spins. Everyone knows that local measurement, statistic of local measurement, tell us what is the phi. What is this phi? If it's singlet, all spins have to be all opposite. If it's not, tomography will tell me. So clearly, this is how I can find relative phase of two separated particles. Now it has two photons. Just one photon, I can absorb this photon in two spins and then look locally on these two spins and find out this phase. Another way is just to do this optical way. I take a laser and take laser here and I look on statistics of detection here. It will give me the phase. Now, this is photon can be absorbed. We need here a charged particle, and there is a paper by Rodolf and Saskind that in fact we can do the same with pions. Somewhat controversial, people superposition of different charges, whatever, but I think it's definitely a good paper and it's and it is okay. It's not a practical one, because if we have a superposition, we can essentially do exactly the same experiment. So we will use not coherent state of photons, coherent state of pions. Coherent state of pions with different charges but the computer very fast, so it's very, it's not feasible to perform that experiment, maybe, or very difficult. But there is no any kind of super selection rule. Some people say there is super selection rule, but then I think they go all wrong. We can't do this kind of experiment. So if we have this charged particle here and here, it will bring many other particles at a coherent state of pile and coherent state here, and then look on local statistics, and this will tell us the case. So there is a way to measure it. So now we have paradox. Before I said that where this phase jumped from 0 to pi has no physical meaning, it's just kind of gauge property, which depending on which gauge you like. Not physical. But now I say I can count this device and measure it to see. I will repeat it many, many times. I will, it happened here, 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 here. I will have a Nunchen sounder, and finally it should tell me where it's happening. So,
but how do you know that the change of phase in one measurement, in one member of the sound, is the same as the change of phase in another member of the sound?
First, I will need an enlarged sample to see the change, but again, I believe in physics and quantum mechanics, so I think all systems, when I know how to prepare, it is a whole story. It's all the same. And this is how it works. Every time I prefer my state, and then my experiment will give you the same statistic. Oh, in some cases, some definite, if I calculate properly, I can arrange properly. So here I put the right flux, so it always go here. It is always go here if I do it properly. So I will do it many times again. And so, first, I do believe that all this measurement, non-local measurement of phase, are okay. I do believe that this out-of-all philosophy analysis is also okay. So there is a contradiction. There is a paradox. Maybe someday you will give me have a hint how the paradox will be resolved.
I have some thoughts
about
it.
What?
I have some thoughts about it.
Okay.
Should I say something now?
I have some, you know, the priority to students, but if no students said it.
I would say for this procedure, you need to provide some particles in the A state or in the B state at these two locations where you want to make the comparison.
Yeah.
So one question is, in your comparison particles, how do you make sure they have the right phase? For example, if you create your comparison particles somewhere and then you move them there, how do you make sure they have not acquired such a phase, for example, from the Aharonov-Bohm solenoid while you move them there?
Resolution. The relative phase of the measuring device, which measures the relative phase of particles, also depends on the chosen gauge. Exactly the same idea you said. So, when I say that my parents have particular phase, to say so, I have to fix the gauge. And then, if I enter or not enter the solenoid, will change their phase exactly, will also change the phase. So the result of experiment should be the same, which phase I consider. This claim of Aharonov-Bohm that there is no moment when the phase flipped is still there. And the fact that I kind of can measure, it's a red herring, because I measure relative to my measuring device, and my measuring device also influenced by the Aharonov-Bohm effect. So it has to be done with charged particles, and this charged particle feel the same potential. So the definition of the phase, you know, when I do all these things, this definition depends there too. So,
By the way, the word red herring, it means something like, it's a distraction, it's not really relevant. It's a kind of illusion.
So, So the paradox one remained very strong. We couldn't destroy it because I was a paradox one, but I said no, this paradox one cannot be true because I have a measurement to show that it's not, I can find where it's happening. No, I cannot. Every place in the path of the wave, there is no observable action, but nevertheless, relative phase is obtained. We still have this big paradox. So now let's go to other small paradoxes. So kind of, I will go here fast because it's important for me to go to the end. There is this Arrhenius-Bohm effect, which says electrons go around solenoids. And then Arrhenius and Kasher looked on what's happening when we have electron and the neutron polarized, and how they move when we keep polarization of neutron all the same. And they realized that the Lagrangian for this system is kind of symmetric between electron and polarized neutron. So when they looked on this symmetry, they said, let's take Arrhenius-Bohm setup and replace. First, they replace the solenoid by many, many neutrons. Every neutron has some magnetic moment. So neutron on neutron on neutron on neutron, it's kind of a flux. And then, after we change it, let's change every neutron by electron and every electron by neutron. So out of Arrhenius-Bohm effect, they got Arrhenius-Kasher effect, which is neutron moves around electric wire because every neutron replaced by charge, so now we have electric wire and charged wire, and here the neutron go around. And they said that this should behave in the same way because it's the same Lagrangian, two particles have the same Lagrangian when we build this system. We should get the same thing, we should get also this topological effect. When neutron go about two sides, it should get phase, it should go this way. It's somewhat less strange than maybe a Arrhenius-Bohm effect, because clearly neutron go inside the field. But they say, okay, this is electric field, this is neutron, it's neutral, so... but anyway, we have this duality. The motion of the electron should be identical to the motion of the neutron. Because the situation is both, is really the same. Everything. And, but, there were attacks by Boyer on Arrhenius-Bohm effect, but was maybe a stronger attack by Boyer on Arrhenius-Kasher effect. Boyer analyzed this thing and said that in this case, there is a clear force on the neutron. Let's see. So, first, we have this. This should be the same like this because this. First, Arrhenius-Bohm effect tells me the behavior of the electron here and behavior of the electron here is the same. Not as if you look on the classical behavior of the wave bucket. Because there is no force, there is no classical leg between these things. Now, there is no reason to say why this is different from this. There is no any kind of thing. We have particle, Mach Zehnder interferometer, it should behave also kind of the same way.
But the field, electrical field is different at any point. So when the electron moves, it's actually seeing a very electric field.
Exactly, but the behavior of the electron with solenoid should be the same, like if you look on the wave packet of the particle, here should be exactly the same. Now, the moving of the wave packet here and moving of the wave packet inside here, also the same. This is what's the whole story about the Bohm effect. Finally, there's kind of strange behavior in the end. But here it's here. But inside, no classical leg. And if there is nothing here, neutron also have no classical leg. But here, there is a claim that there is a classical leg because there is a force. Now let's explain this force. So the claim is that the Arrhenius-Kasher effect, there is a force. He has a claim that there is no force because there is no field. And so in that, we want to say that these two are supposed to be dual, the same. But one with force and one without force, the behavior should be different. So, again, the motion inside, with solenoid, without solenoid, should be the same. Of course, electron and neutron should also be the same. Now, so here, if it's, we're supposed, if it's all dual, that's also be the same. But here we know that there is a force. So something is, so, first I have to show why there is a force. Why force here is not zero. A neutron go around line of charge. Maybe to simpler, let's make this geometry. We have this line of charge, neutron split, and then go straight line here and straight line here. So the claim is that this neutron will feel force like this here, force like this here, and here it will accelerate and then decelerate. Why it's happening? Because what is neutron? Neutrons have magnetic moment. And we might have this model, but you know, today's physics says there are no magnetic monopoles. So neutron, it's a current loop. Neutron must be something like this. Now, when you have a current loop moving, special relativity tells us that it has a dipole electric field. Just contraction, but and this dipole electric dipole is just V cross mu over C. It's easily understand because density of charges, even if you have a neutral current, but the density changes depending if current move with or without velocity because of this kind of relativistic effect. And so if you have at this dipole moment depend on velocity. If velocity is v cross mu. So when the particle goes this way, the dipole moment is like this. And the force given by this expression. So it's important if electric field, it depends on the direction of electric field. And this tells us this formula tells us exactly this picture, that here the force is slows down, make faster, this accelerate, etc. So clearly it will go faster here, because the velocity here will be bigger than the velocity here. And we'll get a classical leg. And so this classical leg explains a lot of Cauchy effect, no miracles, maybe a lot of Bohm has, but here should not be a miracle, but we get a paradox because Saranov Kasher has this good argument that it should be dual, should be the same. But Boyer says, look on this effect, we must have force. And in fact, this paper came when I was in South Carolina with Philip Byrne, on sabbatical in South Carolina. And came out this paper, we showed to Aronoff, and Aronoff's reaction was the following. Cannot be true. Why it cannot be true? He said, let's put two mirrors here. This force, you remember, it was dipole and the field. It depends on the dipole. And the dipole depends on the velocity. So when it goes this way, the dipole was one way. When it goes backwards, the dipole is another way, vector in another way. So, and what will happen, then the force will flip. Here the force is direction. So he wanted to consider you just consider this part. We would say that we expect this kind of thing, that this is kind of normal. But now let's add this Boyer's force. Boyer's force says that we should have force here when it goes here. But when velocity flips, and so the force flips. know what we'll get. You see, the force is this, but now with the field it's the same conservation of field, but velocity flips. When velocity flips, the dipole flips, so the force flips. So what will happen? If we'll start with a particle moving there, it will be accelerated all the time. So we'll get a perpetual momentum. So this is what Aronov told us, and he didn't want to touch this. He said it's wrong. But we had to answer Boyer. So we worked and we thought about how to solve this, because the calculation really says that it's a force. It's kind of strange force because it brings perpetual membrane, it looks like. But we needed to resolve this. It took like 2 months. I came with the solution. The same day, Philip Perl found a reference with the solution. And the reference with the solution is as a paradox, a canon with a record, which called Shockley and James paradox. This paradox is the following. They consider two, but for us it's good enough. This current loop here and the charge here. And let's say superconducting current, charge here, of course, its current gives some magnetic field here, but if it's not moving, nothing happening. So it's kind of stable situation, nothing moves. There is a current. But then the temperature goes up, the superconductor stops to be superconductor, and the current slows down. When the current slows down, you can understand it was kind of magnetic fields and flux. So there is a change in magnetic field and a change in flux, and there is electromotive force which kicks, let's do it again, which when it stops, it's kick, this magnetic electromotive force kicks the electron. But when you try to think about the field of electron on this neutral current, you don't see why it should do something to it. So you get something which kind of in mechanics not supposed to happen. You have a cannon without recoil. Electron shoots, but this stays. And so the solution of this is really this rediscovery of hidden momentum. To resolve this, we had to find that there is interesting situation. You see, everything is kind of at least stationary. But it turned out that in this configuration there is a linear momentum. Not zero linear momentum, mechanical momentum. Inside the things, whatever model you do, there is a linear momentum. When the current stops, this hidden momentum transfers to be not hidden. It's when we have this current inside the field, there is hidden momentum, but when there is no current, no pole, and it's kind of became not hidden, and what is really happening, that this hidden momentum became not hidden and started moving. So there is no really, you cannot, there is no such a thing like recoil free cannon. There is this hidden momentum. What is hidden momentum? How we can get it? The paradox of two Lorentz observers. This is a paradox which I gave at the beginning, which I think it's really, this paradox, one can formalize 30 years before special theory of relativity, and it enforces special theory of relativity. It cannot be that in Alice's frame, acceleration is zero, and in Bob's frame, acceleration is not zero. And the explanation, you remember, you shoot a charged particle and you make some calculation, you say, oh, there is no field in the resultant direction. If there is no field in the resultant direction, also there is no force in the resultant direction. If there is no force, then kind of you decide, no force, acceleration must be zero. You say F equal ma. F0, A equals 0. But when we study special relativity, we know F equals ma is not the right way to write it, to put it. The right way to put it is dp dt equal F. And what is p? It's mv. Now, we had some horizontal v, we had some m, but the particles start accelerate up. When it accelerates up, m goes up, because now it's gamma m, and the gamma became bigger, go faster. So if m go up, the vertical horizontal velocity should go down. So it should slow down. So the resolution is that you have to take into account that the mass change, or at least the momentum, this is what has to be considered. In this thing, you have to take into account the change in the mass. This explains hidden momentum. How explains hidden momentum? Consider this simple model of a current. I have a tube, and I have a charged particle kind of moving freely inside the tube. This electric field will accelerate them and decelerate them. So here they move slower than here. Here they move fast, here they move slow. Now, we know that nothing happened to charge in special relativity. Moves faster, slower, charge is the same charge. So the current, and there is the current in every moment, should, every cross section should be the same. So the sum of qi, vi have to be the same here and here. It means it's the density of charges here should be bigger than the density of charges here, otherwise the current will be different. And this is the equation. Each particle carries charge, each particle carries mass. So if this is true, also this is true. This is true when you get rest mass, because you replace. This is true, and for each particle, each charge, there is kind of rest mass. But if you multiply this mass by a gamma, this is not true anymore. And this is what you have to do when you calculate momentum. So if you look on momentum here, and you look on momentum here, it will be different. The momentum here is bigger than momentum here. But nothing moved. There is this linear mechanical momentum, but nothing moved. Maybe if you study special relativity, there is general theory that the center of mass of the system should go as the total momentum divided by the total energy. How these things reconciled here? The same, this mechanical momentum is equal to electromagnetic momentum, because there is electromagnetic field. You integrate vector pointing all over, it will give you exactly the minus of this. So just integrating the electromagnetic field, seeing that it's not zero, you have to understand that it should be some other momentum, because the total momentum, just nothing move. This ball, this charge plus this not moving together. So the total momentum should be zero. Now, there is this mechanical and electromagnetic, they kind of cancel each other. But in the moment when it stopped moving, then there is no electromagnetic momentum anymore. And then, of course, no mechanical momentum. Total mechanical momentum is zero. This one moves like this, and this should move there. So there is hidden momentum. A simple expression, in fact, for hidden momentum. If you have electric dipole, magnetic dipole, and there is a field there, E. Inside, there is a hidden mechanical momentum, mu cross E. Some whatever units that you want to know. So, there is a speed hidden here. And first, it resolves the Aronoff paradox. There is a force, true. But what this force does, it does not cause acceleration, because it changes hidden momentum. This is what the purpose of this force. There is a force, but no acceleration. F dp dt, and this p is mv plus hidden momentum. This hidden momentum, m, is kind of the total mass of the system. The hidden momentum is inside the electron that parallels. So what's really happening with this hidden, this f is exactly equal to the hidden momentum. So there is no perpetual mobile, unfortunately, it's continuing to move with constant velocity back and forth. And zero acceleration, and this resolves this. It is true, Boyle is right, f is not zero. But he is not right that a is not zero. A is zero, so the behavior, the kinematical behavior of a wave packet in Aronov Bohm is the same like in Aronov Kasher. Although it's a little more difficult to understand because there is a force in Aronov Kasher, but this force doesn't accelerate the neutrons. It only changes the hidden momentum of a neutron. Okay. So the motion of neutrons inside the interferometer is the same with or without charge. We still have this paradox one. In every place on the path of the wave packet of the particle, there is no observable action, but nevertheless, the relative phase is obtained. We also add the Aronov-Kasher effect, which has similar kind of paradoxical phenomena. We can conclude paradox one is an unavoidable property of both Aronov-Bohm and Aronov-Kasher effect, which makes them non-local topological effect. This is, I think, part of what I was talking 10 years ago in this Aronov-Bohm 50 conference. Moreover, let me kind of strengthen this paradox. The solenoid causes a relative phase without classical leg. I also was asked by Hebrew Encyclopedia, I don't know if it's on the internet or not, but in paper no one reads this kind of thing. Anyway, I added this kind of entry about Aronov-Bohm in Hebrew, and I wrote this, until the discovery of the Aronov-Bohm effect, it was believed that the phase is just an auxiliary concept for calculating fields which have direct physical effects. So, essentially, this first paradox, the Nazarick formulation, that potentials are really kind of physical. So there were many talks, and I prepared this talk, and I thought more, and I felt uncomfortable with this. And then I finally came to the conclusion that this is wrong. There is no this paradox. This paradox also can be resolved. There is no this topological non-locality in physics. Potentials are not necessarily physical. It is true that in quantum mechanics we all work with potential when there is no other quantum mechanics. But the only proof not to look for something different was the Aronov-Bohm effect, which showed that the potentials are physical in quantum mechanics. I don't believe so now that this is true. I found a local explanation for Aronov-Bohm effect. What is a local explanation? It is true that there is a field zero here. It is true that nothing happened to an electron. But electron put some field on a solenoid. And Aronov-Bohm, as it presented, solenoid is classical. But classical physics is dead. There is no classical physics. Everything should be quantum. Everything should be explained quantum mechanical. If we take some classical thing, we can get wrong conclusion. Now what I did, I made a model of a solenoid and considered it as a quantum object and looked what electron field does on a solenoid. And of course, you see electron come here, when it changes direction, it changes magnetic field here, the change magnetic flux through the solenoid. It changed magnetic flux through the solenoid. It must be electromagnetic force which rotates the solenoid. This one doesn't, and this rotates. So we have different situation. And so they, during this motion, they rotate differently. So, good explanation is a one, is a local one, and in this paper I put how it works, maybe just a few. And the idea is, so we have this electron in superposition A plus B, we have this solenoid. Then, during the evolution, the solenoid evolved differently. Essentially, the all what's happening here, the changes, the solenoid, it's really, it acquires a phase. Solenoid acquires this phase. I calculate this phase, it turned out to be exactly the Aronov ball phase. But I understand it's, this explanation was not any kind of non-local or topological spooky action at a distance. It was just through electromagnetic field of the electron. So in the end, because what happening? There is entanglement. When it goes this arm and this goes this arm, the solenoid behave differently. There is entanglement. When I go second arm, they disentangle. But during the entanglement period, there is a relative phase between these two branches. Doesn't matter who got the phase. You don't see that when you have quantum particles, you don't know where is the phase. So you can measure this phase on an electron. Solenoid acquired the phase, electron measured this phase. Now here is kind of detailed explanation how it's happened with some formula, but let's keep this just exact model. Two cylinders and rotating in different direction with different charge densities. This is how I got this exactly Aronov-Bohm phase. You remember the phase, the shift and now the shift, the connection between shift and phase. So I consider here there is some shift of my solenoid, and I got exactly the Aronov-Bohm phase. So let's not enter here. Not, there is no time for this. So it's important. Clear. What's important, the entanglement was in between. So there is kind of non-locality, and I have to stress, there is non-locality in physics, inside the many worlds too. Wave functions are non-local. In the many worlds interpretation and other things, no collapse, but it still has wave function. And the wave function is non-local concept. So there is entanglement. Entanglement is kind of non-locality. It's not action at a distance. There is no action at a distance, but there is this non-locality of entanglement. And this entanglement can be changed only locally. Electron sends kind of interaction here and change. The field comes here, and the field is physical. Field can change something, not potential. So I want to believe physics interaction only through local fields. Potentials are just useful auxiliary for mathematical tools. There is no formulation like this. There is no quantum mechanics of the form F equal to M. Now, there is no theory. The theory is only Schrödinger equation. Schrödinger equation essentially it's a conservation of energy equation in kind of quantum form, and its energy is potential. So we don't have this explanation, which I would find as a good one. But I think I have a hint that it's the right way to go, and maybe we'll find it. What is my hint? That it's my idea that if there is no force, there's no field, nothing happens. Everything goes through local fields. I have an example, not very trivial, not so trivial example, in which there are all kinds of potentials all over. But locally, on particles, there are no fields. And then I say, if there is a particle, no field, there should be no effect. And indeed, there is no effect. I can calculate in the standard way with potentials, and this is no effect. But it's not so simple to do it to do it in a standard way. So this example, it's an electric Aronov-Bohm effect. And which my version is like this. It's kind of I have interferometer. This is interferometer. This one mirror, another mirror, and a beam splitter. So when I send a particle, it splits, And it's but now I add to this something. Let me do it again. This is charged particle. It splits, it's come to some mirrors, special mirrors when it's kind of waiting. Then I bring charges to put some potential. But charges are from two sides, so there's no field. So the particle don't feel no field here because no charges here. And here there is no field because I put another charged particle from both sides. And so this gives me some more potential here, and because of this more potential, my interference is different. Without charges it will go this way, with charges it goes this way. Now, I want to arrange special situations that my particles don't feel any field. So it's kind of a high school example, a particular one. What I do, if this is electron, I put my charges to be, electron is minus E, my charges is 40. So what I take this, they come here, exactly do this, and exactly. Let me start the experiment again. Goes here. Now you see there is kind of interesting situation here, because it was both here and here, but the claim is, in the end of the day, I don't get the Arnold-Bohm effect. Arnold-Bohm effect, when I got potential, it should go here. But I say, no, it doesn't happen, it still go up. No, because when I put the potential, it should go here. In principle, like, there is a potential, but here somehow no effect. Let me explain using my field story why there is no effect. Here, it's far away, no charges, no fields, no problem. Here the force is zero. Of course, when they are far away, the force is zero, and here the force is zero. They are far away on my charge particle. Here, when they come, this is kind of a dangerous place. So they're very close. The force might get force, but of course, this one do not get force. But this one also do not get force. Maybe somebody immediately tell me why. Because this is electron, and this is four times electron with another side. But the distance is twice. So the field here is zero. And the field here is zero too. So there is a field zero in all places. In all this experiment, we had force zero, force zero, force zero. No force. So all particles are present only in the field zero places. And therefore, there should be no effect. Now, in fact, Aronov had some kind of paper with potential, and he considered similar effect, and he said, oh, it's interesting, nothing happened. But he considered with potential and explained, because, again, it's not that the calculation is incorrect, it's just the interpretation. I can interpret it locally. One can say, what's about this standard Arnold-Bohm phases, whatever. What really happening, if I consider everything quantum, I have electron and I have solenoid. Now I have to consider everything quantum. And so I have to consider also Arnold-Bohm phase of solenoid. I will get three contributions. One contribution is Arnold-Bohm effect with potential for electron. One contribution, Arnold-Bohm effect for solenoid. And one, my real contribution through real forces. So then it's decision what's to cancel. One way is to say, okay, it's a 2-6 for solenoid, let's cancel them. And then there is a one Arnold-Bohm for electron. I say, no, this is a potential. I don't want to listen about potential. This is kind of auxiliary method, it will come out right, but it's not real physics. Real physics is only local local fields. So everything is potential at this regard. And consider only things with local fields, and they get a correct answer.
So the summary, essentially, of this last part, the standard approach to AB effect is the paradoxical of non-local feature of quantum mechanics. AB phase is acquired inside the interferometer, in spite of the fact that there is no particular place in time where it's happening. The paradox disappears when the relevant parts of the system are considered. The phase is gradually acquired by the source of the electromagnetic potential, the source. And the interference observed by the electron is due to the phase acquired locally by the source. And you get the field of the electron. The core of the effect is that quantum wave function is for all systems together. But surprisingly, the effect can take place almost without entanglement between the source and the electron. There must be entanglement. I cannot get it without entanglement, but I need only very little entanglement. During this process, the entanglement might be minor. In the end, this is what's responsible for the effect. But it's not that situation that they're completely entangled and then something happened. It's not like entanglement in DPR, and it's the most important thing. So we start with this, then there is a coupling, and they are here entangled, and they disentanglement, and they get this phase. And the entanglement is because these states are different, but they're very little different. Just since I almost finished, so. And the AB phase in the free electromagnetic field, the AB experiment with superconducting shielding. Okay, I didn't talk about this, sorry. I had this paper, I discussed it with Zaharonov, he didn't like, of course he liked, of course or not of course. He agreed that technically I'm correct, but he wrote a paper with seven other examples that said they will not be able to explain. I had some reply which explaining, saying that some I really don't know, but he doesn't also know, some of them I explained. And one of the things which I don't know how to deal with is this Tomomura experiment when they put this super conducting shielding, there is a particular phase. But it's not that because I have to take the model of superconductor, it's complicated. It's not that there is a paradox that I don't. There is something which is very difficult to calculate. They don't know how to calculate, I don't know how to calculate. But it's not. What is how the shielding is a difficult issue, still all the problem. The evolution of charged particle in the originary experiment can be described completely by fields. Location of all particles that are not agree with the original one. So the road to quantum theory without potential is open. But this is really difficult, probably beyond me. One has to understand a lot of field theory, completely change quantum mechanics, to make new quantum mechanics without potential. This will be important because it really will show how it's local. It will use only local fields. With the only non-local ingredient that is in public. And so I think it's interesting to work on it. Even if it will be more complicated, the fact that it exists, it will say that the nature is more local than one can think otherwise. Thank you. Up to pi. We still can have this electrons, Saharonov bomb effect,
of the face part, not of the any face. They should be quantized because of this. But to deal with it, there is all kind of it's difficult problem how to analyze the shielding. And there are different ways that they also don't know exactly how to calculate, so. But it's open problem, maybe somebody can shed light on it. Maybe I had a grant on this to work with Aronov of discussing exactly who is right about Aronov effect. At the end of the day, I really had a postdoc working on many words, a philosopher. So now I have a grant for working on many words, but if somebody can solve this problem, great. I also have another postdoc position for kind of two-state vector, but it's all flexible. So one thing that you can make progress in is these kind of questions are interesting. Yes.
I have a question. So in connection with the Aharonov-Bohm effect, people often talk about vector bundles. And it seems to me that with vector bundles, you can also get a local explanation of the Aharonov-Bohm effect. So let me explain that briefly, and then you can react to that. So maybe let me explain very briefly what a vector bundle is. The idea is that at every point in space, there's associated a vector space. And in this case, the vector space would be a one-dimensional complex vector space. And the idea would be that the value of the wave function, psi of x, is not just a complex number, but it's some vector in this one-dimensional vector space. Now, of course, every one-dimensional vector space, you can represent this vector just by one number. But you see, you can choose a basis in that vector space, so your identification of that vector space with the complex numbers, that could be done in different ways. It depends on your choice of basis. Now, when you want to write down derivatives of a function of this kind, so if psi of x is always an element of this vector space, then we call it Vx, the vector space associated with x. Then you have trouble when you want to compute derivatives of psi, because psi of x is in a different space than psi of x prime, which is nearby. So in order to form the difference between psi of x prime and psi of x, you need to somehow identify elements of Vx and Vx prime. And a rule for doing that for neighboring points, that is called the connection. Okay, with the connection you can define a derivative operator, which is called a covariant derivative, and then you can write down the Schrödinger equation, things like that. So a connection defines an identification, like a unitary mapping from one vector space to the other for nearby vector spaces. And the point about these connections is that if you consider two points that are not nearby, then you could consider some path leading from one point to the other point, and along this path you can always identify neighboring the vector spaces Vx for neighboring points, so that and put these together so it would give you an identification between the vector space at your initial and at your final point. But this identification depends then on the path you chose. So for different paths, you would identify these two vector spaces in different ways. Good. Now, the idea here is that what we write down as vector potential, the A mu, is really a connection in this bundle of vector spaces. And now, if you choose a basis in each of these vector spaces, then the connection can be written down as this vector potential A mu, but it depends on your choice of basis. So a different choice of basis will give you different A mu's. That's the kind of the origin of the gauge freedom in this picture of bundles. Now, in this situation of the Aharonov-Bohm effect, the idea would be following. So for this for this particular magnetic field, that corresponds to a particular connection between these your vector spaces. Now, the connection is a very local thing. You only talk about how to identify the Vx with Vx prime when x and prime are neighboring points, infinitesimally separated. Then as you propagate a wave packet along a certain path, then, because you solve the Schrödinger equation, your derivatives all depend on this connection. And the connection is such that in the end, these two different paths that the two different wave packets travel, they have different, they correspond to different identifications between the vector spaces, and that is then where this phase difference comes from. So in total, the explanation is completely local, and it. You get in the end that that you have this phase difference. You can't pin down where the phase difference came in because that depends on your choice of bases, but you get everything out. So that's the picture.
So this is exactly, you say local. The local, what's local is not, because for me, if you go here, and with the solenoid and without solenoid, there is no experiment which will tell me that there is a difference. So, you go here, there is no difference. Then, I don't want to believe that if something goes here around, should feel this difference. And your picture is very much like the other picture. You say that some connection, whatever, this solenoid somehow changes something here. As for me, it's complicated, not clear, and it doesn't sound like local picture for me, that here there is some reality which affects the electrons that go around. And this kind of strange, this reality is not measurable. And the fact it is not measurable, so I say, forget about it, there is no, with solenoid, without solenoid, there is no difference whatsoever, it's exactly the same. So nothing changes here. Electron doesn't feel anything whatsoever. Nothing. What's happening? Electron became entangled with other particles. This I believe. This is quantum mechanics has this entanglement. It's a miracle. It's non-local feature. The action was electron, electron, solenoid. And then they became entangled. And then you have to consider two systems together. So when these things interfere, it's not that something happened to electrons, something happened to solenoid. But because it was entangled with the solenoid, now the whole system has entanglement, and there is a phase between these two branches, and this phase I find on my electron, but electron didn't feel anything, no connection, nothing. And the picture, if locally I cannot see it, it's, there is nothing there. And now this all, this is, seems to me to take this vector potential and make it more sophisticated. Why you call it now local? I don't know. You said it's gauge
connection,
gauge invariant. So for me, if you can gauge out, there is nothing here. If in some gauge there is nothing here, there is nothing here. So, and in my picture, there is nothing here, nothing in this trajectory. In this way, a roller ball is correct. Nothing happened to the electron. What he did realized that when electron goes, it interacts with some other particle and there is an entanglement in the quantum mechanics, we have to consider all particles together, and this explains the Aronne-Bohm effect, but not action on an electron. Nothing happened to electron. Electron did something to others. And because of this, and became entangled, in the end you could see it on electron, but nothing happened to it. Well, the only thing it's happened because it's interacted with something, it became entangled. And this, like, if I have electron, go here and go here. Here there is empty space. Here there are all kinds of pluses, and here is pluses. And like a wrench, again, I put it here, and then I put some charges here. So the field here is zero. So electron doesn't feel anything. But still, in the end, when I bring them together, there is an interference different. Why is interference different? It's not because electron felt something. Because electron became entangled with these charges, it pushed it. So there is an, and then it explained what happened here. But if I ask the reality of electron here, nothing whatsoever. The reality here is the field is zero, electron field is zero. And that, so me, this kind of picture, okay, there are different pictures. There is this, even when you look on classical mechanics, there is a Newtonian simple picture, F equal ma in all particles. And then in the second year we study analytical mechanics, we say, no, it's a kind of, for first year students, we have F equal ma. But real story, we have action. And then there is a minimal action of this global thing, and this is real physics. I think it's important that there is local physics behind it. It has interesting properties, that it has global formulation, that it's also minimize some function or whatever. But what is really happening is kind of particles kicks each other, it creates fields and kicks each other. This is what's really happening. And then it has kind of interesting properties, sort of global type properties like. And another bomb effect was look like it's a global type property without local explanation. And now I have local explanation through that. It touches these things, create entanglement, which is kind of a big miracle, and I, maybe it's there.
You replace one miracle, which you say potential, with another miracle, which you call entanglement.
No, no. But entanglement, it's, we already used entanglement, many other things, entanglement is there, and the potential, it's an additional one, it's not, the, so I think entanglement is enough.
Okay.
You don't need potential.
Just
entanglement, the non-locality of entanglement is good enough, you don't need any kind of gauge gauge potentials. They are useful, it's much easier if I want to calculate the velocity, how it will find out, much easier to use conservation of energy than to make forces every moment. But it's not necessary. I can calculate by local gravitational force at every moment. And this is really what I believe happening. And this other thing, okay, nice, we have some easy, some, but it's not that the conservation of energy, this is the physics. Conservation of energy is a property of physics. And the physics is there is a gravitational field which touches the thing all the time. And the same here. There is a field which rotates this, so doesn't do anything to electron. And the fact that it's in superposition here, that this became in superposition, then in the end it's arranged that it's not entangled anymore, but there is a remnant in the face which we get here.
So in the bundle picture, the idea would be that when you turn on the current in the solenoid, then fields will propagate inward and outward at the speed of light, and so will from the solenoid, and so will the connection in the bundle picture. So if you have a stable current there, you will have a stable connection in the space surrounding it, and this connection is well, people say the holonomy is locally trivial. That means locally, always, if you use the Schrödinger equation with derivatives in the sense of the connection, then a particle, the wave function will just be transported with this connection. Now, and this, if you locally, it's true that two different paths connecting two points. Will lead to the same result when you transport a vector in this bundle with the connection. But globally, it's not true. If you go left around the solenoid or right around the solenoid, that leads to different results. They have this phase difference. So I think I think this actually is a local explanation, and I think you're dismissing it too hastily.
That's it. I don't know. I think it's very different. What you say, that putting this solenoid here changes the space. And I say, no, this thing does not change anything. I don't need it. And it's the Rondon-Bohm effect is correct. I don't want to say there is anything wrong about it. And there you calculate it, it looks like topological, it looks like something happened of this, and I think the bundle is maybe the most sophisticated and exact representation of this. First you mentioned that you switch on the current, and then we don't talk about the signaling. There is no signaling, so it's like we really consider two situations, one with one and without one. So the question how to consider. One way, it's really that it works. To say, okay, it changes the space. Makes this connection different. So now the electron which will behave in this space are different. And so this is kind of, I prefer to say, no, we have one space, I don't play with it, it's the same three-dimensional space, nothing happened to it. And I can explain everything, just my particles interacting with other particles.
Basically, it's not so much a change in space and three-dimensional space, it's a change in the value space of the wave function. Instead of saying the value psi of x is always in the same space, the complex numbers, now you say it's always in different spaces, v sub x.
Okay. If this solenoid and without solenoid, you will consider your electron different. This is what should explain your Aronne-Bohm effect. So you change somehow, there is a one story, this exists, another story, it doesn't. Now this kind of wave function will be different. Now, I say, no, I don't need it. I have this, I avoid, there is no potential, there is no vector potential. Of course, the standard say I can write, but I will write the wave function, I put A. I don't put A, no A. There's no potential. So this electron doesn't feel any potential. Almost everything goes through fields. And these fields affect this, and then they have entanglement, and this explains why the interference is different. Nothing happened to electron. It's only that it became entangled with this. And it's also true that maybe it's, sometimes it's nicer, it's easier to calculate using the standard way, which is correct. But I think the essence, what is really there, if the space change or not change, I think this is what's important, what if how things are. The only, and I say, no, but potential is just, it's a revolution. People, it's too, long time, now some people everything potential, of course, physical. I say, no, the physical things are things which are observable. And here there is a gravitational field, I can test it. Here there is potential, which you can choose any number. It has no physical meaning, from my point of view. You can use it, but it's only a mathematical tool. Field, here there is field, so I have a picture which explains everything by measurable quantity. If here there is nothing measurable locally, I think there is nothing here. No, I don't need this connection, don't need anything else. Of course, when I want to introduce this classical field, whatever, then the one way do it is, oh, there is this kind of connection, I will write quantum mechanics for my electron differently. I say, I don't want it, because I want everything quantum, I want also to describe my solenoid. Then I don't need different description of my electron. It's the same description as if there is no electron. It just I have to see what this electron does to the solenoid. Yes.
There's something which is bothering me. So you say that you can use mathematics, and sometimes you attach some physical meaning to it, and sometimes not. For instance, when you get to the same result, for instance, and to avoid potentials, so you say it's just a way, mathematical way to do it. So it seems a little bit artificial. For instance, even when you say there really exist forces and using potential for potential energy, it's just a nice way to get faster to the solution, but this does not have any fundamental meaning. But how to decide what? So it's just a question of belief. Do you believe in forces or in some deeper sense of?
In classical physics, there is now this, everyone agrees. The potentials are auxiliary. Why? Because everything can be explained with fields.
Yes.
And if I can explain everything with fields in quantum mechanics, so again, I can say potential is just auxiliary concept. And so this was example saying, no, no fields and effect. And I say, no, you're just looking quantum mechanically on everything. There are fields here which explain the effect. And it's, I was pretty surprised that I got the same around the whole phase. I put this trajectory, I put this trajectory, whatever I could calculate, I get the same idea phase. It's, so I don't need that. I can explain everything without. And it's, of course, it's interesting that there are some shortcuts and other explanations. And sometimes these other explanations are conceptually different. Aronoff, we fight all the time. He likes non-locality. And he finds very interesting effects in his model of variable, which have interesting non-local equation. But they say modular variable is non-local concept. Modular momentum, he has explanation of two slits like local. He kind of, because the modular momentum of particle changes when you close or open this. But I say, of course, it may be of interest and give intuition, and then you can find new things when you think in a different language. But I think it's very important. You cannot have really local explanation. If there is a local explanation, again, the word local, there is entanglement, that it is non-local, but a part of the entanglement, I say, everything is entangled, but this entangled wave can be changed only locally. So this is the picture, and I think all this kind of thing, it's a global. Another Bohm effect is global. I cannot describe it locally. And if I take this classical field, the fact that I was able to do it locally, considering everything quantum, and since anyway, I believe classical physics we know in experiment, forget about it. So I think that it tells me that there is no kind of this kind of global features. Gravity, you have no idea, and general relativity is very global theory and what to do. We are very far away. It would be interesting to find also this, but I'm not there. I really don't know. And also the standard quantum mechanics. Everything is done with potential. And there are some things with fields, but you can use, instead of potential, you can use fields. But then there are no local action. Aronoff is very happy with this, maybe even more. He says if the magnetic field non-locally affect electron. And I don't like it. There's no non-local action. I want only local action. So, at least for this, I find an explanation. So today, I don't know any example of this situation that there's something acts non-local.
London equation, which is
No problem. It's superconductivity. We have enough time. Its wave function is propagated. You can ground any kind of ground state. Everything you can solve equation. It's just the ground state after this. There is a Aronoff Bohm effect of this type, and there is a ground state Aronoff Bohm effect, which is kind of similar thing. And I have an explanation for this too. I put an electron in a ground state, and I see the ground state should be different with solenoid. And then I say, okay, there is entanglement with the solenoid, and there is a solution. There is no. Sometimes systems are complex, and there is no paradox. There is no way. This is a clear way. A lot of Bohm effect was clear way. But you should believe in kind of local explanation. There are some global problems. And I found a way that because there is interaction with the source, you don't need these global properties. You can have local explanation of things together with entanglement.
Lambda diamagnetism.
It's solid state, whatever. It's all things are pretty complicated, but I don't know any clear example. When Aronoff Bohm was clear example. This I thought. No other. There are all kind of phenomena, but the time scale. So there is a time for the wave to go here and there. There is this Mössbauer effect. Somehow we see the whole thing because there is a time to interact with the whole body. So the same kind of. explanation might happen to superfluidity, conductivity, this kind of stuff.
Maybe we should stop here for the lunch break, and then let's say for the exercise session, we meet again at 1:50.
You wanted to make photo session?
Ah, yes, we should also do that. We wanted to take a group photo, and maybe the best time is now, before the lunch. So let's all go to the terrace. That's probably the best place for taking the photograph. But first of all, let's thank Lev again for